What's that out there on my porch? Mad villagers with fork and torch? No, just some twice-masked Halloweeners. Trick-or-treaters, candy gleaners. A witch, a bat, a sheedy ghost come to beg your humble host, Julie Billy Spears, to fill their sacks with stuff to make them ill. Instead, I'll give them, from Monroe County Civic Theater's Oc-Poe-ber Fest, a tasty poem or juicy story read to them by the very best and only volunteer company around. Our thanks to them and you who found your way to reach our website, where we invite you all good times to share, www.mcct.org. And you just might, while you're there, if you've anything to spare, click www.mcct.org/support. Oh, the bells, the bells, the bells. Luckily, I have a big supply of tasty Poe to go, to keep those goody goblin goblins there at bay. Keep your sheets on for some facts I think you'd like to know about the woeful Mr. Poe's unfortunate last days. After his wife Virginia's death, Poe's complicated and uneasy love life did little to relieve his emotional turmoil and increasing mental fragility. On October 3rd, an election day in 1849, he was found laying in a gutter in Baltimore Street in someone else's clothes. He was incoherent, staggering, and in dire shape. There's a lot of mystery and several theories about what may have happened to him. Why was he in this condition? Where did he get those clothes? Had he voted yet? He was admitted to the hospital. On the night before his death, he repeatedly called out the name Reynolds. No one has any idea what this meant. Perhaps being foiled by life, he decided to call it a wrap. Poe died on October 7th, 1849. Bizarre events related to Poe didn't stop with his death. He was buried in an unmarked grave, and when he finally obtained a tombstone, it was destroyed in a train accident. In 1863, medium Lizzie Doten claimed that Poe's ghost came to her reciting poetry that he wanted to be published. He could be the first real ghostwriter. Poe was best known for his short horror stories and poems, but he was also known as a critic by his peers, a cryptographer, a cosmologist, an editor, and a lecturer. He was a man haunted by tragedy and poverty for most of his life. His final words were, "Lord, help my poor soul." If he could have known how much pleasure and inspiration his writing would bring to generations of readers and writers, perhaps it may have brought a smile to his famously brooding countenance. Poe's still very much a part of our culture today. Few writers and artists have not been influenced by Poe. Those who have include H.P. Lovecraft, Marcel Duchamp, Alfred Hitchcock, Salvador Dali, Tim Burton, and many, many more. He's one of the most recognizable figures of the 19th century. His likeness even appears in Batman comics and Scooby-Doo cartoons. Our first reading comes from Roy Sillings. Bells, a very onomatopoeic poem, was published after Poe's death in 1849. Poe coined the word tintinnabulation in this poem to describe the sound made by ringing of bells.
Hear the sledges with the bells, silver bells. What a world of merriment their melody foretells. How they tinkle, tinkle, tinkle in the icy air of night, while the stars that oversprinkle all the heavens seem to twinkle with a crystalline delight. Keeping time, 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 in a sort of runic rhyme to the tintinnabulation that so musically wells from the bells, 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 from the jingling and the tinkling of the bells. Hear the mellow wedding bells, golden bells. What a world of happiness their harmony foretells. Through the balmy air of night, how they ring out their delight. From the molten golden notes, and all in tune, what a liquid ditty floats to the turtle dove that listens while she gloats on the moon. Oh, from out the sounding cells, what a gush of euphony voluminously wells, how it swells, how it dwells, on the future how it tells of the rapture that impels to the swinging and the ringing of the bells, 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 of the bells, 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 to the rhyming and the chiming of the bells. Hear the loud alarum bells, brazen bells! What tale of terror now their turbulency tells? In the startled ear of night, how they scream out their affright! Too much horrified to speak, they can only shriek, shriek, out of tune, in a clamorous appealing to the mercy of the fire, in a mad expostulation with the deaf and frantic fire, leaping higher, 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 with a desperate desire and a resolute endeavour now, now, to sit or never by the side of the pale-faced moon. Oh, the bells, bells, bells! What a tale their terror tells of despair! How they clang and clash and roar! What a horror they outpour on the bosom of the palpitating air! Yet the ear it fully knows, by the twanging and the clanging, how the danger ebbs and flows. Yet the ear distinctly tells, in the jangling and the wrangling, how the danger sinks and swells by the sinking and the swelling in the anger of the bells. Of the bells, of the bells, 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 in the clamour and the clangour of the bells. Hear the tolling of the bells, iron bells. What a world of solemn thought their monody compels. In the silence of the night, how we shiver with affright at the melancholy menace of their tone. For every sound that floats from the rust within their throats is a groan. And the people, ah, the people, they that dwell up in the steeple all alone, and who tolling, tolling, tolling in that muffled monotone feel a glory in so rolling on the human heart a stone. They are neither man nor woman, they are neither brute nor human, they are ghouls. And their king it is that tolls, as he rolls, 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 rolls a paean from the bells, and his merry bosom swells with the paean of the bells, and he dances, and he yells, keeping time, 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 in a sort of runic rhyme, to the paean of the bells, keeping time, 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 in a sort of runic rhyme, to the throbbing of the bells, 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 to the sobbing of the bells, keeping time, 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 as he knells, 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 in a happy runic rhyme, to the rolling of the bells, 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 to the trolling of the bells, 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 to the moaning and the groaning of the bells.
In our next reading, first published in 1844, the narrator enters a world filled with ghouls and dark angels and ruled by a kingly spirit. Nothing is as it should be. No, it's not Disneyland, or even Washington, D.C. It's Dreamland. Here's Emily Mcgee.
By a route obscure and lonely, haunted by ill angels only, where an Eidolon named Knight on a black throne reigns upright, I have reached these lands but newly from an ultimate dintuli, from a wild, weird clime that lieth sublime out of space, out of time. Bottomless vales and boundless floods and chasms and caves and titan woods, with forms that no man can discover for the tears that drip all over. Mountains toppling evermore into seas without a shore, seas that restlessly aspire, surging unto skies of fire, lakes that endlessly outspread their lone waters, lone and dead, their still waters still and chilly with the snows of the lulling lily. By the lakes that thus outspread their lone waters, lone and dead, their sad waters sad and chilly with the snows of the lulling lilies, by the mountains near the river, murmuring lowly, murmuring ever, by the gray woods, by the swamp where the toad and the newt encamp, by the dismal tarns and pools where dwell the ghouls, by each spot most unholy, in each nook most melancholy, there the traveler meets aghast sheeted memories of the past, shrouded forms that start and sigh as they pass the wanderer by, white-robed forms of friends long given in agony to the earth and heaven. For the heart whose woes are legion, 'tis a peaceful, soothing region. For the spirit that walks in shadow, 'tis an El Dorado. But the traveler, traveling through it, may not, dare not, openly view it. Never its mysteries are exposed to the weak human eye unclosed. So wills its king who hath forbid the uplifting of the fringed lid. And thus, the sad soul that here passes beholds it but through darkened glasses. By a root obscure and lonely, haunted by ill angels only, where an eidolon named Night on a black throne reigns upright, I have wandered home but newly from this ultimate dim thule.
Read by Rene, Llewellyn, The System of Dr. Tarr and Professor Fether is a satire. A traveler thinks it would be fun to visit a madhouse. It turns out to be a crazy idea. At the time the story was written, the treatment of mental health patients was a significant political issue. People were calling for asylum reform because the mentally ill were being treated with abuse, while the insanity defense was being used by criminals in order to get acquitted for their crimes and avoid punishment.
Autumn of 1844, while on a tour through the extreme southern provinces of France, my route led me within a few miles of a certain maison de santé, or private madhouse, about which I had heard much in Paris from my medical friends. As I had never visited a place of the kind, I thought the opportunity too good to be lost, and so proposed to my traveling companion, a gentleman with whom I had made casual acquaintance a few days before, that we should turn aside for an hour or so and look through the establishment. To this he objected, pleading haste in the first place, and in the second, a very usual horror at the sight of a lunatic. He begged me, however, not to let any mere courtesy toward himself interfere with the gratification of my curiosity, and said that he would ride on leisurely, so that I might overtake him during the day, or at all events during the next. As he bade me good-bye, I bethought me that there might be some difficulty in obtaining access to the premises, and mentioned my fears on this point. He replied that, in fact, unless I had personal knowledge of the superintendent, Monsieur Maillard, or some credential in the way of a letter, a difficulty might be found to exist, as the regulation of these private madhouses was far more rigid than the public hospital laws. For himself, he added, he had, some years since, made the acquaintance of Maillard, and would so far assist me as to ride up to the door and introduce me, although his feelings on the subject of lunacy would not permit his entering the house. I thanked him, and turning from the main road, we entered a grass-worn bypath, which, in half an hour, nearly lost itself in a dense forest clothing the base of a mountain. Through this dank and gloomy wood, we rode some 2 miles when the Maison de Santé came in view. It was a fantastic chateau, much dilapidated, and indeed scarcely tenable through age and neglect. Its aspect inspired me with absolute dread. Checking my horse, I half resolved to turn back. Soon, however, I grew ashamed of my weakness and proceeded. As we rode up to the gateway, I perceived it slightly open, and the visage of a man peering through. In an instant afterward, this man came forth, accosted my companion by name, shook him cordially by the hand, and begged him to alight. It was Monsieur Maillard himself. He was a portly, fine-looking gentleman of the old school, with a polished manner and a certain air of gravity, dignity, and authority, which was very impressive. My friend, having presented me, mentioned my desire to inspect the establishment, and received Monsieur Maillard's assurance that he would show me all attention, now took leave, and I saw him no more. When he had gone, the superintendent ushered me into a small and exceedingly neat parlor, containing, among other indications of refined taste, many books, drawings, pots of flowers, and musical instruments. A cheerful fire blazed upon the hearth. At a piano, singing an aria from Bellini, sat a young and very beautiful woman, who at my entrance paused in her song and received me with graceful courtesy. Her voice was low and her whole manner subdued. I thought, too, that I perceived the traces of sorrow in her countenance, which was excessively, although to my taste, not unpleasingly pale. She was attired in deep mourning and excited in my bosom a feeling of mingled respect, interest, and admiration. I had heard at Paris that the institution of Monsieur Maillard was managed upon what is vulgarly termed the system of soothing, that all punishments were avoided, that even confinement was seldom resorted to, and that the patients, while secretly watched, were left much apparent liberty, and that most of them were permitted to roam about the house and grounds in the ordinary apparel of persons in right mind. Keeping these impressions in view, I was cautious in what I said before the young lady, for I could not be sure that she was sane. And, in fact, there was a certain restless brilliancy about her eyes, which half led me to imagine that she was not. I confined my remarks, therefore, to general topics, to such that I thought would not be displeasing or exciting even to a lunatic. She replied in a perfectly rational manner to all that I said, and even her original observations were marked with the soundest good sense. But a long acquaintance with the metaphysics of mania had taught me to put no faith in such evidence of sanity, and I continued to practice throughout the interview the caution which I commenced it. Presently, a smart footman in livery brought in a tray with fruit, wine, and other refreshments of which I partook, the lady soon afterwards leaving the room. As she departed, I turned my eyes in an inquiring manner towards my host. "No," he said. Oh, no. A member of my family, my niece, and a most accomplished woman." "Oh, I beg a thousand pardons for the suspicion," I replied. "But, of course, you will know how to excuse me. The excellent administration of your affairs here is well understood in Paris, and I thought it just possible, you know—" "Yes, yes, say no more. Rather, it is myself who should thank you for the commendable prudence you have displayed. We seldom find so much forethought in young men, and more than once some unhappy contretemps has occurred in consequence of thoughtlessness on the part of our visitors. While my former system was in operation, my patients were permitted the privilege of roaming to and fro at will, they were often aroused to a dangerous frenzy by injudicious persons who called to inspect the house, Hence, I was obliged to enforce a rigid system of exclusion, and none obtained access to the premises upon whose discretion I could not rely. "While your former system was in operation," I said, repeating his words, do I understand you then to say that the soothing system of which I have heard so much is no longer in force?" "Oh, it is now," he replied. "Several weeks since we have concluded to renounce it forever." "Indeed, you astonish me." "We found it, sir," he said with a sigh, "absolutely necessary to return to the old usages. The danger of the soothing system was, at all times, appalling, and for its advantages have been much overrated. I believe, sir, that in this house it has been given a fair trial, if ever in any. We did everything that rational humanity could suggest. Sorry that you could not have paid us a visit at an earlier period that you might have judged for yourself. But I presume you are conversant with the soothing practice, with its details?" "Not altogether. What I have heard has been at third or fourth hand." "I may state the system, then, in general terms, as one in which the patients were menage humored. We contradicted no fantasies which entered the brains of the mad. On the contrary, we not only indulged but encouraged them, and many of our most permanent cures have thus been effected. There is no argument which so touches the feeble reason of the madman as the argumentum ad absurdum. We have had men, for example, who fancied themselves chickens. The cure was to insist upon the thing as a fact, to accuse the patient of stupidity in not sufficiently perceiving it to be a fact, and thus to refuse him any other diet for a week than that which properly appertains to a chicken. In this manner, a little corn and gravel were made to perform wonders. But was this species of acquiescence all? By no means. We put much faith in amusements of a simple kind, such as music, dancing, gymnastic exercises, generally, cards, certain classes of books, and so forth. We affected to treat each individual as if for some ordinary physical disorder, and the word lunacy was never employed. A great point was to set each lunatic to guard the actions of all the others, to repose confidence in the understanding or discretion of a madman is to gain him body and soul. In this way, we were enabled to dispense with an expensive body of keepers. And you had no punishments of any kind?
None.
And you never confined your patients?
Very rarely. Now and then the malady of some individual growing to a crisis or taking a sudden turn of fury, we conveyed him to a secret cell, lest his disorder should infect the rest, and there kept him until we could dismiss him to his friends. For with the raging maniac we have nothing to do. He is usually removed to the public hospitals.
And you have now changed all this, and you think it is for the better?
Decidedly. The system had its disadvantages, even its dangers. But it is now, happily, exploded through all the maisons de santé of France.
I am very much surprised, I said, at what you tell me. For I made sure that, at this moment, no other method of treatment for mania existed in any portion of the country.
You are young yet, my friend, replied my host. But the time will arrive when you will learn to judge for yourself of what is going on in the world without trusting to the gossip of others. Believe nothing you hear and only one half of what you see. Now, about our maisons de santé, it is clear that some ignoramus has misled you. After dinner, however, when you have sufficiently recovered from the fatigue of your ride, I will be happy to take you over the house and introduce to you a system which, in my opinion, and in that of everyone who has witnessed its operation, is incomparably the most effectual as yet devised. Your own, I inquired, one of your own invention?
I am proud, he replied, to acknowledge that it is, at least in some measure.
In this manner I conversed with Monsieur Maillard for an hour or two, during which he showed me the gardens and conservatories of the place.
I cannot let you see my patients, he said, just at present.
To a sensitive mind there is always more or less of the shocking in such exhibitions, and I do not wish to spoil your appetite for dinner. We will dine. I can give you some veal à la Saint-Menehoul, with cauliflowers and velouté sauce, and after that, a glass of Clos du Vigeau. Then your nerves will be sufficiently steadied. At 6, dinner was announced, and my host conducted me into a large salle à manger, where very numerous company were assembled, 25 or 30 in all. They were apparently people of rank, certainly of high breeding, although their habiliments, I thought, were extravagantly rich, partaking somewhat too much of the ostentatious finery of the vieille cour. I noticed that at least 2/3 of these guests were ladies, and some of the latter were by no means accoutred in what a Parisian would consider good taste at the present day. Many females, for example, whose age could not have been less than 70, were bedecked with a profusion of jewelry, such as rings, bracelets, and earrings, and wore their bosoms and arms shamefully bare. I observed, too, that very few of the dresses were well made, or at least that very few of them fitted the wearers. In looking about, I discovered the interesting girl to whom Monsieur Maillard had presented me in the little parlor. But my surprise was great to see her wearing a hoop and farthingale, high-heeled shoes, a dirty cap of Brussels lace, so much too large for her that it gave her face a ridiculously diminutive expression. When I had at first seen her, she was attired most becomingly in deep mourning. There was an air of oddity, in short, about the dress of the whole party, which at first caused me to recur to my original idea of the soothing system, and to fancy that Monsieur Maillard had been willing to deceive me until after dinner, that I might experience no uncomfortable feelings during the repast at finding myself dining with lunatics. But I remembered having been informed in Paris that the southern provincialists were a peculiarly eccentric people, with a vast number of antiquated notions. And then, too, upon conversing with several members of the company, my apprehensions were immediately and fully dispelled. The dining room itself, although perhaps sufficiently comfortable and of good dimensions, had nothing too much of elegance about it. For example, the floor was uncarpeted. In France, however, a carpet is frequently dispensed with. The windows, too, were without curtains. The shutters, being shut, were securely fastened with iron bars applied diagonally, after the fashion of our ordinary shop shutters. The apartment, I observed, formed in itself a wing of the chateau, and thus the windows were on 3 sides of the parallelogram, the door being at the other. There were no less than 10 windows in all. The table was superbly set out. Oh, it was loaded with plate, and more than loaded with delicacies. The profusion was absolutely barbaric. There were meats enough to have feasted the Anakim. Never in all my life had I witnessed so lavish, so wasteful an expenditure of the good things of life. There seemed very little taste, however, in the arrangements, and my eyes, accustomed to quiet lights, were sadly offended by the prodigious glare of a multitude of wax candles, which in silver candelabra were deposited upon the table and all about the room wherever it was possible to find a place. There were several active servants in attendance,
and upon a large table at the farther end of the apartment were seated 7 or 8 people with fiddles, fifes, trombones, and a drum. These fellows annoyed me very much at intervals during the repast by an infinite variety of noises, which were intended for music and which appeared to afford much entertainment to all present, with the exception of myself. Upon the whole, I could not help thinking that there was much of the bizarre about everything I saw. But then the world is made up of all kinds of persons, with all modes of thought and all sorts of conventional customs. I had traveled so much as to be quite an adept at the nil admirari, so I took my seat very coolly at the right hand of my host, and, having an excellent appetite, did justice to the good cheer set before me. Conversation, in the meantime, was spirited and general. The ladies, as usual, talked a great deal. I soon found that nearly all the company were well-educated, and my host was a world of good-humored anecdote in himself. He seemed quite willing to speak of his position as superintendent of a maison de santé, and indeed the topic of lunacy was, much to my surprise, a favorite one with all present. A great many amusing stories were told having reference to the whims of the patients. "We had a fellow here once," said a fat little gentleman who sat at my right, "a fellow that fancied himself a teapot. By the way, is it not specially singular how often this particular crochet has entered the brain of the lunatic? There is scarcely an insane asylum in France which cannot supply a human teapot. Our gentleman was a Britannia-ware teapot, and was careful to polish himself every morning with buckskin and whiting." "And then," said a tall man just opposite, "we had here, not too long ago, a person who had taken it into his head that he was a donkey, which, allegorically speaking, you will say was quite true. He was a troublesome patient, and we had much ado to keep him within bounds. For a long time he would eat nothing but thistles. But of this idea we soon cured him by insisting upon his eating nothing else. And then he was perpetually kicking out his heels. So, Mr. de Kock, I will thank you to behave yourself." Here interrupted an old lady who sat next to the speaker. "Please keep your feet to yourself. You have spoilt my brocade. Is it necessary, pray, to illustrate a remark in so practical a style? Our friend here can surely comprehend you without all this. Upon my word, you are nearly as great a donkey as the poor unfortunate imagined himself. Your acting is very natural, as I live."
"Mille pardons, mademoiselle," replied Monsieur de Kock, thus addressed. "A thousand pardons. I had no intention of offending. Mademoiselle Laplace, Monsieur de Kock will do himself the honor of taking wine with you." Here Monsieur de Kock bowed low, kissed his hand with much ceremony, and took wine with Mademoiselle Laplace. "Allow me, mon ami," now said Monsieur Mallard, addressing myself, "allow me to send you a morsel of this veal à la Saint-Menehould. You will find it particularly fine." At this instant, 3 sturdy waiters had just succeeded in depositing safely upon the table an enormous dish, or trencher, containing what I suppose to be monstrum horrendum informe in jean qui lumen ademptum. Closer scrutiny assured me, however, that it was only a small calf roasted whole, set upon its knees with an apple in its mouth, as is the English fashion of dressing a hare. "Thank you, no," I replied. "To say the truth, I am not particularly partial to veal à la Saint. What is it? For I do not find that it altogether agrees with me.
I will change my plate, however, and try some of the rabbit. There were several side dishes on the table, containing what appeared to be ordinary French rabbit, a very delicious morceau which I can recommend. "Pierre," cried the host, "change this gentleman's plate, and give him a side piece of this rabbit au chaud."
"This what?" said I.
"This rabbit au chaud."
Why, thank you. Upon second thoughts, no. I will just help myself to some of the ham. Oh, there is no knowing what one eats, thought I to myself, at the tables of these people of the province. I will have none of their rabbit au chaud, and for that matter, none of their cat au rabbit either.
"And then," said a cadaverous-looking personage near the foot of the table, taking up the thread of the conversation where it had been broken off, "and then, among other oddities, we had a patient, once upon a time, who very pertinaciously maintained himself to be a Cordova cheese, and went about with a knife in his hand, soliciting his friends to try a small slice from the middle of his leg."
"He was a great fool, beyond doubt," imposed someone. "But not to be compared with a certain individual whom we all know, with the exception of this strange gentleman. I mean, the man took himself for a bottle of champagne, and always went off with a pop and a fizz in this fashion." And here the speaker, very rudely, I thought, put his thumb in his left cheek, withdrew it with a sound resembling the popping of a cork, and then, by dexterous movement of the tongue upon the teeth, created a sharp hissing and fizzing, which lasted for several minutes, in imitation of the frothing of champagne. This behavior, I saw plainly, was not very pleasing to Monsieur Maillard, but that gentleman said nothing, and the conversation was resumed by a very lean little man in a big wig.
"And then there was an ignoramus," said he, "who mistook himself for a frog, which, by the way, he resembled in no little degree. I wish you could have seen him, sir." Here the speaker addressed myself. "It would have done your heart good to see the natural airs that he put on. Sir, if that man was not a frog, I can only observe that it is a pity he was not. His croak, thus, warg, warg, was the finest note in the world, B-flat. And when he put his elbows upon the table, thus, after taking a glass or two of wine, and extended his mouth, thus, rolled up his eyes, thus, winked them with excessive rapidity, thus, why then, sir, I take it upon myself to say, positively, that you would have been lost in admiration and genius of the man."
"I have no doubt of it," I said.
"And then there was Petit Gaillard, who thought himself a pinch of snuff, and was truly distressed because he could not take himself between his own finger and thumb. And then there was Jules Desoliers, who was a very singular genius indeed, and went mad with the idea that he was a pumpkin. He persecuted the cook to make him up into pies, a thing which the cook indignantly refused to do. And for my part, I am by no means sure that a pumpkin a la Desoliers would not have been very capital eating indeed."
"You astonish me," said I, and I looked inquisitively at Monsieur Maillard.
"Ha, ha, ha," said that gentleman. "Oh, oh, oh, very good indeed. Oh, you must not be astonished, mon ami. Our friend here is a wit, a droll. You must not understand him to the letter."
"And then," said some other one of the party, "then there was Buffon le Grand, another extraordinary personage in his way. He grew deranged through love, and fancied himself possessed of two heads. One of these he maintained to be the head of Cicero. the other he imagined a composite one, being Demosthenes from the top of the forehead to the mouth, and Lord Brougham from the mouth to the chin. And it is not impossible that he was wrong, but he would have convinced you of his being in the right, for he was a man of great eloquence. Oh, he had an absolute passion for oratory and could not refrain from display. For example, he used to leap upon the dinner table thus, and here a friend at the right of the speaker put a hand upon his shoulder and whispered a few words in his ear, upon which he ceased talking with great suddenness and sank back within his chair. And then, said the friend who had whispered, there was Boula, the teetotum. I call him the teetotum because, in fact, he was seized with a droll but not altogether irrational crochet that he had been converted into a teetotum. Oh, you would have roared with laughter to see him spin. He would turn round upon one heel by the hour in this manner. So, and here the friend whom he had just interrupted by a whisper performed exactly similar office for himself. But then, cried the old lady at the top of her voice, your Monsieur Boulot was a madman, and a very silly madman at best. For who, allow me to ask you, has ever heard of a human teetotum? Oh, the thing is absurd. Madame Joyeuse was a more sensible person, as you know. She had a crochet, but it was instinct with common sense, and gave pleasure to all who had the honour of her acquaintance. She found, upon mature deliberation, that by some accident she had been turned into a chicken cock. But as such she behaved with propriety. She flapped her wings with prodigious effect, so and so and so, and as for her crow, it was delicious. Cock-a-doodle-doo! Cock-a-doodle-doo! Cock-a-doodle-dee-doo-dee-doo-dee-doo! Madame Joyeuse, I will thank you to behave yourself. Here interrupted our host very angrily. You can either conduct yourself as a lady should do, or you can quit the table forthwith. Take your choice. The lady, with whom I was much astonished to hear her addressed as Madame Joyeuse, after the description of Madame Joyeuse she had just given, blushed up to the eyebrows and seemed exceedingly abashed at the reproof. She hung down her head and said not a syllable in reply. But another and younger lady resumed the theme. It was my beautiful girl of the little parlour. Oh, Madame Joyeuse was a fool, she exclaimed. But there was really much sound sense, after all, in the opinion of Eugenie Saussafe. She was a very beautiful and painfully modest young lady who thought the ordinary mode of habiliment indecent and wished to dress herself always by getting outside instead of inside her clothes. It is the thing very easily done, after all. You only have to do so, and then so, 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 and then so, 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 and then... Mon Dieu, Mademoiselle Saussafe! Here cried a dozen voices at once. What are you about? Oh, forbear, that is sufficient. We see very plainly how it is done. Hold, hold! Several persons were already leaping from their seats to withhold Mademoiselle Saussafe from putting herself on a par with the Medician Venus, when the point was very effectually and suddenly accomplished by a series of loud screams or yells from some portion of the main body of the chateau. My nerves were very much affected indeed by these yells, but the rest of the company I really pitied. I never saw any set of reasonable people so thoroughly frightened in my life. They all grew as pale as so many corpses, shrinking within their seats, sat quivering and gibbering with terror, listening for a repetition of the sound. Oh, it came again, louder, and seemingly nearer, and then a third time, very loud. And then a fourth time, with vigor evidently diminished. this apparent dying away of the noise, the spirits of the company were immediately regained, and all life and anecdote as before. And I now ventured to inquire as to the cause of the disturbance.
"A mere bagatelle," said Monsieur Maillard. "We are used to these things, and care really very little about them. The lunatics, every now and then, get up a howl in concert, one starting another, as is sometimes the case with a bevy of dogs at night. It occasionally happens, however, that the concerto yells are succeeded by a simultaneous effort at breaking loose, when, of course, some little danger is to be apprehended."
"And how many have you in charge?"
"At present, we have not more than 10 altogether."
"Principally females, I presume?"
"Oh, no. Every one of them men, and stout fellows, too, I could tell you."
"Indeed. I have always understood that the majority of lunatics were of the gentler sex."
"It is generally so, but not always. Now, some time ago, there were about 27 patients here. And of that number, no less than 18 were women. But largely matters have changed very much, as you see."
"Yes, have changed very much, as you see," here interrupted the gentleman who had broken the shins of Mademoiselle Laplace.
"Yes, have changed very much, as you see," chimed in the whole company at once.
"Hold your tongues, every one of you," said my host in a great rage. Whereupon the whole company maintained a dead silence for nearly a minute.
As for one lady, she obeyed Monsieur Maillard to the letter, thrusting out her tongue, which was an excessively long one, and held it very resignedly with both hands until the end of the entertainment.
"And this gentlewoman," said I to Monsieur Maillard, bending over and addressing him in a whisper, "this good lady who has just spoken, who gives us the cock-a-doodle-dee-doo. I presume she is harmless, quite harmless, eh?"
"Harmless!" ejaculated he in unfeigned surprise. Why, what can you mean?"
"Only slightly touched," I said, touching my head. "I take it for granted that she is not particularly, not dangerously affected, eh?"
"Mon Dieu! What is it you imagine? This lady, my particular old friend, Madame Joyeuse, is absolutely sane as myself. She has had her little eccentricities, to be sure, but then, you know, all old women, all very old women, are more or less eccentric."
"To be sure," said I, to be sure. "Then the rest of these ladies and gentlemen?"
"Are my friends and keepers," interrupted Monsieur Maillard, drawing himself up with hauteur. "My very good friends and assistants."
"What? All of them?" I asked. "The women and all?"
"Assuredly," he said. "We could not do it all without the women. Why, they are the best lunatic nurses in the world. They have a way of their own, you know. Their bright eyes have a marvelous effect. Something like the fascination of the snake, you know."
"To be sure," I said, "to be sure. They behave a little odd, eh? And they're a little queer, eh? Don't you think so?"
"Odd? Queer? Why do you really think so? We are not very prudish, to be sure, here in the South. Do pretty much as we please, enjoy life and all that sort of thing, you know."
"To be sure," said I, to be sure.
"And then, perhaps, this clou de vigeau is a little heady, you know, a little strong, you understand, eh?"
"To be sure," I said, "to be sure. By the by, monsieur, did I understand you to say that the system you have adopted in place of the celebrated soothing system is one of very vigorous severity?"
"By no means. Our confinement is necessarily close, but the treatment, the medical treatment, I mean, is rather agreeable to the patients than otherwise."
"And the new system is one of your own invention?"
"Not altogether. some portions are referable to Professor Tarr, of whom you had necessarily heard. And again, there are modifications in my plan, which I am happy to acknowledge as belonging to the right of the celebrated Fether, with whom, if I mistake not, you have the honor of an intimate acquaintance. I am quite ashamed to confess, I replied, that I have never even heard the name of either gentleman before.
Good heavens! Ejaculated my host, drawing back his chair abruptly and lifting his hands. I surely do not hear you aright. You did not intend to say, eh, that you had never heard either of the learned Dr. Tarr or of the celebrated Professor Fether?
I am forced to acknowledge my ignorance, I replied, but the truth should be held inviolate above all things. Nevertheless, I feel humbled to the dust not to be acquainted with the works of these no doubt extraordinary men. I will seek out their writings forthwith and peruse them with deliberate care. Monsieur Maillard, you have really made me ashamed of myself. And this was the fact. Say no more, my good young friend, he said kindly, pressing my hand. Now join me in a glass of Sauternes. We drank. The company followed our example without stint. They chatted, they jested, they laughed, they perpetrated 1,000 absurdities. The fiddles shrieked, the drum rode. The trombones bellowed like so many brazen bulls of Phalaris, and the whole scene, growing gradually worse and worse as the wines gained the ascendancy, became at length a sort of pandemonium in petto. In the meantime, Monsieur Maillard and myself, with some bottles of Sauternes and Vougeot between us, continued our conversation at the top of our voice. A word spoken in an ordinary key stood no more chance of being heard than the voice of a fish from the bottom of Niagara Falls. And sir, I said, screaming in his ear, you mentioned something before dinner about the danger incurred in the old system of soothing. How is that? Yes, he replied. There was occasionally great danger indeed. There is no accounting for the caprices of madmen, and in my opinion, as well as that of Dr. Tarr and Professor Fether, it is never safe to permit them to run at large unattended. A lunatic may be soothed, as it is called, for a time, but in the end he is very apt to become obstreperous. His cunning, too, is proverbial and great. If he has a project in view, he conceals his design with a marvelous wisdom, and the dexterity with which he counterfeits sanity presents, or to the metaphysician, one of the most singular problems in the study of mind. When a madman appears thoroughly sane, indeed, it is high time to put him in a straitjacket. But the danger, my dear sir, of which you were speaking, in your own experience, during your control of this house, have you had practical reason to think liberty hazardous in the case of a lunatic? Here, in my own experience? Why, I may say yes. For example, not very long time ago, a singular circumstance occurred in this very house. The soothing system, you know, was then in operation, and the patients were at large. They behaved remarkably well, especially so. Anyone of sense might have known that some devilish scheme was brewing from that particular fact, that the fellows behaved so remarkably well. And sure enough, one fine morning, the keepers found themselves pinioned hand and foot and thrown into the cells where they were attended as if they were the lunatics by the lunatics themselves who had usurped the offices of the keepers. You don't tell me so. I never heard of anything so absurd in my life. Fact. It all came to pass by means of a stupid fellow, a lunatic,
who by some means had taken it into his head that he had invented a better system of government than any ever heard of before. Of lunatic government, I mean. He wished to give his intervention a trial, I suppose, and so he persuaded the rest of the patients to join him in a conspiracy for the overthrow of the reigning powers. And he really succeeded. No doubt of it. The keepers and kept were soon made to exchange places. Not that exactly either. For the madmen had been free, but the keepers were shut up in cells forthwith and treated, I'm sorry to say, in a very cavalier manner. But I presume a counter-revolution was soon effected. This condition of things could not have long existed. The country people in the neighborhood, visitors coming to see the establishment, would have given the alarm. Oh, there you are, out! The head rebel was too cunning for that. He admitted no visitors at all, with the exception one day of a very stupid-looking young gentleman of whom he had no reason to be afraid. He let him in to see the place, just by way of variety, to have a little fun with him. As soon as he had gammoned him sufficiently, he let him out and sent him about his business. And how long, then, did the madman reign? Oh, a very long time indeed. A month, certainly. How much longer, I can't precisely say. In the meantime, the lunatics had a jolly season of it, that you may swear. They doffed their own shabby clothes and made free with the family wardrobe and jewels. The cellars of the chateau were well stocked with wine, and these madmen are just the devils that know how to drink it. They lived well, I can tell you. And the treatment? What was the particular species of treatment which the leader of the rebels put into operation? Why, as for that, a madman is not necessarily a fool, as I have already observed. And it is my honest opinion that his treatment was a much better treatment than that which it superseded. It was a very capital system indeed. Simple, neat, no trouble at all. In fact, it was delicious. It was. Here my host's observations were cut short by another series of yells of the same character as those which had previously disconcerted us. This time, however, they seemed to proceed from persons rapidly approaching. "Gracious heavens!" I ejaculated. "The lunatics have most undoubtedly broken loose!" "I very much fear it is so," replied Monsieur Mallard, now becoming excessively pale. He had scarcely finished the sentence before loud shouts and imprecations were heard beneath the windows, and immediately afterwards it became evident that some persons outside were endeavouring to gain entrance to the room. The door was beaten with what appeared to be a sledgehammer, and the shutters were wrenched and shaken with prodigious violence. A scene of most terrible confusion ensued. Monsieur Maillard, to my excessive astonishment, threw himself under the sideboard. I had expected more resolution at his hands. The members of the orchestra, who, for the last 15 minutes, had been seemingly too much intoxicated to do duty, now sprang all at once to their feet and to their instruments, and scrambling upon their table, broke out with one accord into Yankee Doodle, which they performed, if not exactly in tune, at least with an energy superhuman during the whole of the uproar. Meantime, upon the main dining table, among the bottles and glasses, leaped the gentleman who, with such difficulty, had been restrained from leaping there before. As soon as he fairly settled himself, he commenced an oration, which, no doubt, was a very capital one, if only it could have been heard. At the same moment, the man with the teetotum predilections set himself to spinning around the apartment with immense energy, and with arms outstretched at right angles from his body.
so that he had all the air of a teetotum, in fact, and knocked down everybody who happened to get in his way. And now, too, hearing incredible popping and fizzing and pain, I discovered at length that it proceeded from the person who performed the bottle of that delicate drink during dinner. And then again, the frogman croaked away as if the salvation of his soul depended upon every note that he uttered. And in the midst of this, the continuous braying of a donkey rose above all. As for my old friend, Madame Joyeuse, I really could have wept for the poor lady. She appeared so terribly perplexed. All she did, however, was to stand up in a corner by the fireplace and sing out incessantly at the top of her voice, "Cock-a-doodle! Cock-a-doodle-dee-doo!" Oh, and now came the climax, the catastrophe of the drama. As no resistance beyond whooping and yelling and cock-a-doodle-dooing was offered to the encroachments of the party without, the 10 windows were very speedily and almost simultaneously broken in. I shall never forget the emotions of wonder and horror with which I gazed when, leaping through these windows and down among us, pell-mell, fighting, stamping, scratching, and howling, there rushed a perfect army of what I took to be chimpanzees, orangutans, or big black baboons of the Cape of Good Hope. I received a terrible beating. After which I rolled under a sofa and lay still. After lying there some 15 minutes, however, during which time I listened with all my ears to what was going on in the room, I came to some satisfactory denouement of this tragedy. Monsieur Maillard, it appeared, in giving me the account of the lunatic who had excited his fellows to rebellion, had been merely relating his own exploits. This gentleman had, indeed, some 2 or 3 years before been the superintendent of the establishment, but grew crazy himself, and so became a patient. This fact was unknown to the traveling companion who introduced me. The keepers, then in number, having been suddenly overpowered, were first well tarred, then carefully feathered, and then shut up in underground cells. They had been so imprisoned for more than a month, during which period Monsieur Maillard had generously allowed them not only the tar and feathers which constituted his system, but some bread and abundance of water. The latter was pumped on them daily. At length, one, escaping through a sewer, gave freedom to all the rest. The soothing system, with important modifications, has been resumed at the chateau. Yet I cannot help agreeing with Monsieur Maillard that his own treatment was a very capital one of its kind. As he justly observed, it was simple, neat, and gave no trouble at all, not the least. I have only to add that, although I have searched every library in Europe for the works of Dr. Tarr and Professor Fether, I have, up to the present day, utterly failed in my endeavors at procuring an edition.
Published in 1842, Frank Buczolich brings us The Pit and the Pendulum, a swinging story about a prisoner brought before sinister judges who prove to be cut-ups. Their favorite mode of torment turns out to be a real side-splitter.
I was sick unto death with that long agony, when they at length unbound me, and I was permitted to sit. I felt that my senses were leaving me. The sentence, the dread sentence of death, was the last distinct accentuation which reached my ears. After that, the sound of the inquisitorial voices seemed merged into one dreamy, indeterminate hum. It conveyed to my soul the idea of revolution, perhaps from its association in fancy with the burr of a mill wheel. This only for a brief period, for presently I heard no more. And for a while I saw, but with how terrible an exaggeration. I saw the lips of the black-robed judges. They appeared to me white, whiter than the sheet upon which I traced these words, and thin, even to grotesqueness, thin with the intensity of their expression of firmness, of immovable resolution, of stern contempt of human torture. I saw that the decrees of what to me was fate were still issuing from those lips. I saw them writhe with a deadly locution. I saw them fashion the syllables of my name, and I shuddered because no sound succeeded. I saw, too, for a few moments, of delirious horror, the soft and nearly imperceptible waving of the sable draperies which enwrapped the walls of the apartment. And then my vision fell upon the seven tall candles upon the table. At first, they wore the aspect of charity, and they seemed white, slender angels who would save me. But then all at once there came a most deadly nausea over my spirit, and I felt every fiber in my frame thrill as if I had touched the wire of a galvanic battery, while the angel forms became meaningless specters with heads of flame. And I saw that from them there would be no help. And then there stole from my fancy, like a rich musical note, the thought of what sweet rest there must be in the grave. The thought came gently and stealthily, and it seemed long before it attained full appreciation. But just as my spirit came at length properly to feel and entertain it, the figures of the judges vanished as if magically from before me. The tall candles sank into nothingness. Their flames went out utterly. The blackness of darkness supervened. All the sensations appeared swallowed up in that mad rushing descent of the soul into Hades. And silence, and stillness, and night for the universe. I had swooned, but will not say that all of consciousness was lost. What of it there remained, I will not attempt to define, or even to describe, yet all was not lost. Deepest slumber, no. In delirium, no. In a swoon, no. In death, no. Even in the grave, all is not lost. Thus, there is no immortality for man. Arousing from the most profound of slumbers, we break the gossamer web of some dream. Yet in a second afterwards, so frail may that web have been, we remember not that we have dreamed. In the return to life from the swoon, there are two stages. First, at the sense of mental or spiritual. Secondly, that of the sense of physical existence. It seems probable that if upon reaching the second stage, we could recall the impressions of the first, we should find these impressions eloquent in memories of the gulf beyond. And that gulf is what? How at least shall we distinguish its shadows from those of the tomb? But if the impressions of what I have termed the first stage are not at will recalled, yet after long interval, do they not come undidden, while we marvel whence they come? He who has never swooned is not he who finds strange palaces and wildly familiar faces in coals that glow. Is not he who beholds floating in midair the sad visions that the many may not view? Is not he who ponders over the perfume of some novel flower? Is not he whose brain grows bewildered with the intense meaning of some musical cadence which has never before arrested his attention? Amid frequent and thoughtful endeavors to remember, amid earnest struggles to regather some token of the state of seeming nothingness into which my soul had lapsed, there have been moments when I have dreamed of success. There have been brief, very brief periods when I have conjured up remembrances which the lucid reason of a later epoch assures me to have had reference only to that condition of which men term unconsciousness. These shadows of memory, indistinctly of tall figures that lifted and bore me in silence, down, down, still down, till a hideous dizziness pressed me at the mere idea of the interminableness of the descent. They also tell me of a vague horror in my heart on account of that heart's unnatural stillness. Then comes a sense of sudden motionlessness throughout all things, as if those who bore me, a ghastly train, had outrun in their descent the limits of the limitless, and paused from the worrisomeness of their toil. After this, I call to mind flatness and dampness, and then all is madness, the madness of a memory which busies itself among forbidden things. Very suddenly, there came back to my soul motion and sound, the tumultuous motion of the heart, and in my ears, the sound of its beating. Then a pause, in which all is blank. Then again sound and motion and touch, a tingling sensation pervading my frame. Then the mere consciousness of existence without thought, a condition which lasted long. Then very suddenly thought and shuddering terror and earnest endeavor to realize my true state, and a strong desire to lapse into insensibility, then a rushing revival of soul and a successful effort to move, and now a full memory of the trial, of the judges, of the tall candles, of the sable draperies, of the sentence, of the sickness, of the swoon, then entire forgetfulness of all that followed, and all that a later day and the much earnestness of endeavor had enabled me vaguely to recall. So far I had not opened my eyes. I felt that I lay upon my back, unbound. I reached out my hand, and it fell heavily upon something damp and hard. Then I suffered it to remain for many minutes, while I strove to imagine where and what I could be. I longed, yet dared not employ my vision. I dreaded the first glance of objects around me. It was not that I feared to look upon things horrible, but that I grew aghast that there should be nothing to see. At length, with a wild desperation at heart, I quickly unclosed my eyes. My worst thoughts were then confirmed. The blackness of eternal night encompassed me. I guess the breath, the intensity of the darkness seemed to oppress and stifle me. The atmosphere was intolerably close. I still lay quietly and made effort to exercise my reason. I brought to mind the inquisitorial proceedings and attempted from that point to deduce my real condition. The sentence had passed. And it appeared to me that a very long interval of time had since elapsed. Yet not for a moment did I suppose myself actually dead. Such a supposition, notwithstanding what we read in fiction, is altogether inconsistent with real existence. But where and what state was I condemned to death. I knew who perished usually in the auto de fe, and one of these had been held up on the very night of the day of my trial. Had I been remanded to my dungeon to wait for the next sacrifice, which would not take place for many months? This I at once saw could not be. Victims had been in immediate demand. Moreover, my dungeon, as well as the condemned cells of Toledo, had stone floors, and light was not altogether excluded. A fearful idea now suddenly drove the blood in torrents upon my heart, and for a brief period I once more relapsed into insensibility. Upon recovering, I at once started to my feet, trembling convulsively in every fiber. I thrust my arms wildly above and around me in all directions. I felt nothing, yet dreaded to move a step, lest I should be impeded by the walls of a tomb. Perspiration burst from every pore and stood in cold, big beads upon my forehead. The agony of suspense grew at length intolerable, and I cautiously moved forward with my arms extended and my eyes straining from their sockets in the hope of catching some faint ray of light. I proceeded for many paces, but still all was blackness and vacancy. I breathed more freely. It seemed evident that mine was not at least the most hideous of fates. And now, as I still continued to step cautiously onward, there came thronging upon my recollection a thousand vague rumors of the horrors of Toledo, of their dungeons there had been strange things narrated, fables I had always deemed them, but yet strange and too ghastly to repeat, save in a whisper. Was I left to perish of starvation in this subterranean world of darkness, or what fate, perhaps even more fearful, awaited me? That the result would be death, and a death more customary, bitterness, I knew too well the character of my judges to doubt. The mode and the hour were all that occupied or distracted me. My outstretched hands at length encountered some solid obstruction. It was a wall, seemingly of stone masonry, very smooth, grimy, and cold. I followed it up, stepping with all the careful distrust which certain antique narratives had inspired me. This process, however, afforded me no means of ascertaining the dimensions of my dungeon, as I might make its circuit and return to the point whence I set out without being aware of the fact, so perfectly uniform seemed the wall. I therefore sought the knife which had been in my pocket when led into the inquisitorial chamber, but it was gone. My clothes had been exchanged for a wrapper of coarse serge. I had thought of forcing the blade in some minute crevice in the masonry so as to identify my point of departure. The difficulty, nevertheless, was the trivial, although in the disorder of my fancy it seemed at first insuperable. I tore a part of the hem from the robe and placed the fragment at full length in at right angles to the wall. In groping my way around the prison, I could not fail to encounter the shred on completing the circuit. So at least I thought, but I had not counted upon the extent of the dungeon, or upon my own weakness. The ground was moist and slippery. I staggered onward for perhaps half an hour, when I stumbled and fell. My excessive fatigue induced me to remain prostrate, and soon overtook me as I lay. Upon awakening and stretching forth an arm, I found beside me a loaf and a pitcher with water. I was too much exhausted to reflect upon the circumstance, but ate and drank with avidity. Shortly afterwards, I resumed my tour around the prison, and with much toil, pain at last upon the fragmented surge. Up to the period when I fell, I had counted 52 paces, and upon resuming my walk, I had counted 48 more when I arrived at the rag. There were in all then 100 paces, and emitting 2 paces to the yard, I presumed the dungeon to be 50 yards in circuit. I had met, however, with many angles in the wall, and thus I could form no guess at the shape of the vault. For the vault, I could not help supposing it to be. I had little object, certainly no hope, in these researches that a vague curiosity prompted me to continue them. Quitting the wall, I resolved to cross the area of the enclosure. At first, I proceeded with extreme caution, for the floor, although seemingly of solid material, was treacherous with slime. At length, however, I took courage and did not hesitate to sit firmly, endeavoring to cross in as direct a line as possible. I had advanced from 10 or 12 paces in this manner, when the remnant of the torn hem of my robe became entangled between my legs. I stepped on it and fell violently on my face. In the confusion attending my fall, I did not immediately apprehend the same circumstance which yet, in a few seconds afterwards, and while I still lay prostrate, arrested my attention. It was this. My chin rested upon the floor of the prison, but my lips and the upper portion of my head, although seemingly at a less elevation than the chin, touched nothing. At the same time, my forehead seemed bathed in a clammy vapor, and the peculiar smell of decayed fungus arose through my nostrils. I put forward my arm and shouted that I had fallen at the very brink of a circular pit, whose extent, of course, I had no means of ascertaining at the moment. Groping about the masonry just below the margin, I succeeded in dislodging a small fragment and let it fall into the abyss. For nearly a minute, I hearkened to its reverberations as it dashed against the sides of the chasm in its descent. At length, there was a sullen plunge into water, succeeded by large echoes. At the same moment, there came a sound resembling the quick opening and as rapid closing of a door overhead, while a faint gleam of light flashed suddenly through the gloom and then suddenly faded away. I now saw clearly the doom which had been prepared for me, and congratulated myself upon the timely accident by which I had escaped. A step farther before my fall, and the world had seen me no more, and the death just avoided was that very character which I had regarded as fabulous and frivolous in the tales respecting the Inquisition. To the victims of tyranny, there was a choice of death with its direct physical agonies, or death with its most hideous moral horrors. I had been reserved for the latter. By long suffering, my nerves had been unstrung until I trembled at the sound of my own voice and had become in every aspect a fitting subject for the species of torture which awaited me. Shaking every limb, I groped my way back to the wall, resolving there to perish rather than risk the terrors of the world for which my imagination now pictured many in various positions about the dungeon. In other conditions of mind, I may have had courage to end my misery at once by a plunge into one of these abysses, but now I was the veriest of cowards. Neither could I forget what I had read of these pits, that the sudden extinction of life formed no part of their most horrible plan. Agitation of spirit kept me awake for many long hours, but at length I again slumbered. Upon arousing, I found by my side, as before, a loaf and a pitcher of water. A burning thirst consumed me, and I emptied the vessel at a draught. It must have been drugged, for scarcely had I drank before I became irresistibly drowsy. A deep sleep fell upon me, a sleep like that of death. How long it lasted, I of course know not. And once again, I unclosed my eyes. The objects around me were visible. By a wild, sulphurous luster, the origin of which I could not at first determine, I was unable to see the extent and aspect of the prison. In its size, I had been greatly mistaken. The whole circuit of its walls did not extend 25 yards. For some minutes, this fact occasioned me in a world of vain trouble. Vain indeed, for what could be of less importance under the terrible circumstances which environed me than the mere dimensions of my dungeon? But my soul took a wild interest in trifles, and I busied myself in endeavors to account for the error I had committed in my measurement. The truth at length flashed upon me. In my first attempt at exploration, I had counted 52 paces up to the period when I fell. I must then have been within a pace or two of the fragment of surge. In fact, I had nearly performed the circuit of the vault. I then slept, and upon awakening, I must have returned upon my steps, thus supposing the circuit nearly double what it actually was. My confusion of mind prevented me from observing what I began my tour with the wall to the left and ended it with the wall to the right. I had been deceived, too, in respect to the shape of the enclosure. In feeling my way, I had found too many angles and thus deduced an idea of great irregularity. So potent is the effect of total darkness upon our arousing from lethargy or sleep. The angles are simply those of a few slight depressions or niches at odd intervals. The general shape of the prison was square. What I had taken for masonry now seemed to be iron or some other metal in each plate. The sutures or joints occasioned the depression. The device to which charnel superstition of the monks has given rise. The figures of fiends and aspects of menace, with skeleton form and other more fearful images, overspread and distribute the wall. I observed that the outlines of these monstrosities were sufficiently distinct, that the colors seemed faded and blurred as if from the effects of a damp atmosphere. I now noticed a floor, too, which was a stone. In the center yawned the circular pit from whose jaws had escaped, but it was the only one in the dungeon. All this I saw indistinctly, and by much effort, for my personal condition had been greatly changed during slumber. I now lay upon my back, and at full length, on a species of low framework of wood. To this I was securely bound by a long strap resembling a sushigal. It passed in many convolutions about my limbs and body, leaving me at liberty, only my head and my left arm to such extent that I could, by dint of much exertion, supply myself with food from an earthen dish which lay at my side on the floor. I saw to my horror that the pitcher was absent. To my horror, for I was consumed with intolerable thirst. This thirst appeared to be the design of my persecutor to assimilate, for the food in the dish was meat, pungently seasoned. Looking upwards, I surveyed the ceiling of my prison. With some 30 or 40 feet overhead, and constructed much as a sidewall. In one of its panels, a very singular figure riveted my whole attention. It was the painted figure of time, as he is commonly represented, save that, in lieu of a scythe, he held what, at a casual glance, I supposed to be the pictured image of a huge pendulum, such as we see on antique clocks. There is something, however, in the appearance of this machine which caused me to regard it more attentively. While I gazed directly upward at it, which the vision was immediately over my own, I fancied that I saw it in motion. In an instant afterwards, the fancy was confirmed. Its sweep was brief, and of course, slow. I watched it for some minutes, somewhat in fear, but more in wonder. Wearied at length with observing its dull movement, I turned my eyes upon the other objects in the cell. A slight noise attracted my notice, and looking into the floor, I saw several enormous rats traversing it. They had issued from the well, which lay just within view to my right. Even then, while I gazed, they came up in truth, hurriedly with ravenous eyes, alerted by the scent of the meat. From this, it required much effort and attention to scare them away. It might have been half an hour, perhaps even an hour, for I could take but imperfect rate of time before I again cast my eyes upward. What I saw then confounded and amazed me. The sweep of the pendulum had increased in extent by nearly a yard. As natural consequence, its velocity was also much greater. What mainly disturbed me was the idea it had perceptibly descended. I now observed with what horror it is needless to say that its nether extremity was formed of a crescent glittering steel about a foot in length from horn to horn, the horns upward and under edge evidently as keen as that of a razor. Like a razor also, it seemed massy and heavy, tapering from the edge into a solid and broad structure above. It was appended to a really weighty rod of brass, and the whole hissed as it swung through the air. I could no longer doubt the doom prepared for me by monkish ingenuity and torture. My cognizance of the pit had become known for the inquisitorial agents. The pit, whose horrors had been destined for so bold a recusant as myself. The pit, typical of hell, and regarded by rumor as the ultima thule of all their punishments. The plunge into this pit I had avoided by a nurse of accidents. I knew that surprise or entrapment into torment formed an important portion of all the grotesquerie of these dungeon deaths. Having failed to fall, it was no part of the demon plan to throw me into the abyss, and thus, there being no alternative, a different and milder destruction awaited me. Milder! I half smiled in the agony that they thought of such application of such a term. What roots it to tell the long, long hours of horror or more immortal during which I counted the rushing vibrations of the steel, inch by inch, line by line, with a descent only appreciable at intervals that seemed ages, down, and still down it came. Days passed. It might have been that many days passed ere it swept so closely over me as to fan me with its acrid breath. The odor of the sharp steel forced itself into my nostrils. I prayed. I wearied heaven with prayer. With mere speedy descent, I grew frantically mad and struggled to force myself upward against the sweep of the fearful scimitar. And then I felt sudden calm and lay smiling at the glittering death as a child at some rare bauble. There was an interval of utter insensibility. It was brief, for upon again lapsing into life, there had been no perceptible descent in the pendulum. But it might have been long, for I knew there were demons who took note of my swoon and who could have arrested the vibration at pleasure. upon my recovery, too, I felt very ill, inexpressibly sick and weak as to long inanition. Even amid the agonies of that period, the human nature craved food. With painful effort, I outstretched my left arm as far as my bonds permitted and took possession of the small remnant which had been spared me by the rats. As I put a portion of it within my lips, there rushed to my mind a half-formed thought of joy, of hope. Yet what business had I with hope? It was, as I say, a half-formed thought. A man has many such which are never completed. I felt that it was a joy of hope, but I felt also that it had perished in its formation. In vain, I struggled to realize, to regain it. Long suffering had nearly annihilated all my ordinary powers of mind. I was an imbecile, an idiot. The vibration of the pendulum was at right angles to my length. I saw that the crescent was designed to cross the region of the heart. It would fray the surge of my robe. It would return and repeat its operation again and again, notwithstanding its terrifically wide sweep, some 30 feet or more, and the hissing vigor of its descent, sufficient under these various walls of iron, still the fraying of the surge of my robe would be all that, for several minutes, it would accomplish. And at this thought, I paused. I dare not go farther than this reflection. I dwelt upon it with a pertinacity of attention, as if, in so dwelling, I could arrest here the descent of the steel. I forced myself to ponder upon the sound of the crescent as it should pass across the garment, upon this peculiar feeling of sensation which a friction of cloth produces in the nerves. I pondered upon all this frivolity until my teeth were on edge. Down, steadily down it crept. I took a frenzied pleasure in contrasting its downward with its lateral velocity. To the right, to the left, far and wide, with the shriek of the plunge of a damned spirit, to my heart, with the stealthy pace of the tiger. I alternately laughed and howled as the one or the other idea grew predominant. Down, certainly relentlessly down, it vibrated within 3 inches of my bosom. I struggled violently, furiously, to free my left arm. This was free only from the elbow to the hand. I could reach the ladder from the platter beside me to my mouth with great effort, but no farther. Could I have broken the fastenings above the elbow? I would have seized and attempted to arrest the pendulum. I might as well have attempted to arrest an avalanche. Down, still unceasingly, still down, inevitably down, I gasped and struggled at each vibration. I shrunk convulsively at its every sweep. My eyes followed it outward or upward, whirls with the eagerness of the most unmeaning despair. They closed themselves sporadically at the descent, although death would have been a relief. Oh, how unspeakable! I still quivered in every nerve to think how slight a sinking or slipping. The machinery would precipitate the keen, listening acts upon my bosom. It was hope that prompted me, the nerve to quiver, the frame to shrink. It was hope, the hope that triumphs on the rack, that whispers to the death-condemned, even in the dungeons of the Inquisition. I saw that some 10 or 12 vibrations would bring me to the actual contact with my robe. And with this observation, there suddenly came over my spirit all of the keen, directed calmness of despair. For the first time during many hours, or perhaps days, I thought, I know at once occurred to me that the bandage or sushing will develop me was unique. I was tied by no separate cord. The first stroke of the razor-like crest and athwart any portion of the band which would so detach that it might be unwound from my person by means of my left hand, but how fearful in that case the proximity of the steel. The result of the slightest struggle was deadly. Was it likely, moreover, that the minions of the torture had not foreseen and provided for this possibility? Was it probable that the bandage crossed my bosom in the track of the pendulum, dreading to find my faint and, as it seemed, my last hope frustrated? I so far elevated my head as to obtain a distinct view of my breast. The surcingle enveloped my limbs and body, close in all directions, save in the path of the destroying crescent. Scarcely had I dropped my head back in its original position, there flashed upon my mind, which I cannot better describe than the unformed half of that idea of deliverance to which I have previously alluded, and which the moiety only folded indeterminately through my brain when I raised food to my burning lips. The whole thought was now present, feeble, scarcely seen, scarcely definite, but still entire. I proceeded at once with the nervous energy of despair to attempt its execution. For many hours, the immediate vicinity of the low framework upon which I lay had been literally swarming with rats. They were wild, bold, ravenous, their red eyes glaring upon me as if they waited for motionlessness on my part to make me their prey. To what food, I thought, have they been accustomed to in the well? They had devoured, in spite of my efforts to prevent them, all but a small remnant of the contents of the dish. I had fallen into a habitual seesaw, a wave of the hand about the platter, and at length the unconscious uniformity of the movement deprived it of effort and effect. In the voracity, the vermin frequently fastened their sharp fangs in my fingers. With the particles of the oily and spicy viand, which now remained, I thoroughly rubbed the bandage whenever I could reach it. Then, raising my hand from the floor, I lay breathlessly still. At first, the ravenous animals were startled and terrified at the change. At the cessation of movement, they shrank alarmedly back. Many sought the well, but this was only for a moment. I had not counted in vain upon their voracity. Observing that I remained without motion, one or two of the bulls leaped upon the framework, and they smelt at the surcingle. This seemed the signal for a general rush. Forth from the well, they hurried in fresh troops. They clung to the wood, they overran it, and leaped in hundreds upon my person. The measured movement of the pendulum disturbed them not at all. Avoiding its scope, they busied themselves with the anointed bandage. They pressed. They swarmed upon me in ever accumulating heat. They breathed upon my throat. Their cold lips sought my own. I was half stifled by the thronging pressure. Disgust that the world has no name swelled my bosom and chilled with a deadly climbing of my heart. Yet 1 minute, I felt that the struggle would be over. Plainly, I could see the weakness of vanity. I knew that more than in one place it must be already present. With a more than human resolution, I lay still. Nor had I erred in my calculation, nor had I erred in vain. I, at length, thought that I was free. The surcingle hung in ribbons from my body, but the stroke of the pendulum had already pressed upon my lips. It had divided the surge of the rope. It had cut through the linen beneath. twice again it's long, my sharp sense of being chopped to every nerve. But the moment of escape had arrived. At the wave of my hand, my deliverers hurried tumultuously away with a steady movement, cautious, sidelong, shrinking and slow, I slid from the embrace of the bandage beyond the reach of the scimitar. For the moment, at least, I was free, free, and in the grasp of the Inquisition. I had scarcely stepped from my wooden metaphor on the stone floor of the prison when the motion of the hellish machine ceased, and I beheld it drawn up by some invisible force to the ceiling. This was a lesson which I took desperately to heart. My every motion was undoubtedly watched. Free. I had but escaped death in one form of agony to be delivered unto worse than death in some other. With that thought, I rolled my eyes nervously around on the barriers of iron that hemmed me in. Something unusual. Some change which at first I could not appreciate distinctly. It was obvious had taken place in the apartment. For many minutes of a dreamy and trembling abstraction, I busied myself in vain and connected conjecture. During this period, I became aware for the first time of the origin of sulphurous light which illuminated the cell. It proceeded from a fissure about half an inch in width, extended entirely around the prison at the base of the walls, which thus appeared and were completely separated from the floor. I endeavored, but of course in vain, to look through the aperture. As I arose from the attempt, the mystery of the alteration of the chamber broke at once upon my understanding. I have observed that, although the outlines of the figures upon the walls were sufficiently distinct, yet the colors seemed blurred and indefinite. These colors had now assumed and were momentarily assuming a startling and most intense brilliancy that gave to the spectral and fiendish portraitures an aspect that might have thrilled even firmer nerves than my own. Demon eyes of a wild and ghastly vivacity glared upon me in thousand directions, which none had been visible before, and gleamed with the lurid luster of a fire that I could not force my diseased imagination to regard as unreal. Unreal! Even while I gazed, there came to my nostrils the breath of the vapor of heated iron. A suffocating odor pervaded the prison. A deeper glow settled each moment in the eyes that glared at my agonies. A richer tint of crimson diffused itself over the pictured horrors of blood. I panted. I gasped for breath. There could be no doubt of the design of my tormentors. Oh, most unrelenting, oh, most demoniac of men. I shrank from the glowing metal to the center of the cell. Amid the thought of the fiery destruction that impended, the idea of the coolness of the well came over my soul like balm. I rushed to its deadly brink. I threw my straining vision below. The glare from the enkindled roof illumined its most inmost recesses. Yet for a wild moment did my spirit refuse to comprehend the meaning of what I saw. At length, of course, it wrestled its way into my soul. It burned itself upon my shuddering reason. Oh, for a voice to speak. Oh, horror. Oh, any horror but this was a shriek. I rushed from the margin and buried my face in my hands, weeping bitterly. The heat rapidly increased, and once again I looked up, shuddering as with a fit of the ague. There had been a second change in the cell, and now the change was obviously in the form. As before, it was in vain that I had first endeavored to appreciate or understand what was taking place, but not long was I left in doubt. The inquisitorial vengeance had been heard by my twofold escape. and there was to be no more dallying with the king of terrors. The room had been square. I saw that two iron angles were now acute, two consequently obtuse. The fearful difference quickly increased with a low rumbling or moaning sound. In an instant, the apartment had shifted its form into that of a lozenge. But the alteration stopped not here. I neither hoped nor desired it to stop. I could have clasped the red walls of my bosom as a garment of a truce of eternal peace. Death, I said, any death but that of the pit. Fool! Might I not have known that into the pit it was the object of the burning iron to urge? Could I resist its glow? Or if even that, could I withstand its pressure? And now, flatter and flatter grew the lozenge. This rapidity, no time for contemplation. Its center, and of course its greatest width, came just over the yawning gulf. I shrank back, but the closing walls pressed me resistlessly onwards. At length, for my seared and writhing body, there was no longer an inch of foothold on the firm floor of the prison. I struggled no more, but the agony of my soul found vent in one loud, long, and final scream of despair. I felt that I tottered upon the brink. I averted my eyes. There was a loud blast of many trumpets. There was discordant hum of human voices. There was a harsh grating as of a thousand thunders. The fiery walls rushed back. An outstretched arm caught my own as I fell fainting into the abyss. It was that of General LaSalle. The Inquisition was in the hand of the enemies. The French army had entered Toledo.
Finally, and I mean finally, we'll conclude with Poe's short story, The Masque of the Red Death, read by Roy Sillings. If you plan to hold a private hoedown in a members-only clubhouse during a deadly pandemic you think you've licked, beware of a party crasher. Hoedowns can become showdowns, and your club can be dismembered by an uninvited guest who makes you sick. Eat up, drink up, live it up, but when your time's up, you'll be struck out by the clock.
Red Death had long devastated the country. No pestilence had ever been so fatal or so hideous. Blood was its avatar and its seal, the redness and the horror of blood. There were sharp pains and sudden dizziness, and then profuse bleeding at the pores with dissolution. The scarlet stains upon the body, and especially upon the face of the victim, with a pest ban which shut him out from the aid and from the sympathy of his fellow men. And the whole seizure, progress, and termination of the disease were the incidents of half an hour. But the Prince Prospero was happy and dauntless and sagacious. When his dominions were half depopulated, he summoned to his presence 1,000 hale and light-hearted friends from among the knights and dames of his court, and with these retired to the deep seclusion of one of his castellated abbeys. This was an extensive and magnificent structure, the creation of the prince's own eccentric yet august taste. A strong and lofty wall girded it in. This wall had gates of iron. The courtiers, having entered, brought furnaces and massy hammers and welded the bolts. They resolved to leave means neither of ingress or egress to the sudden impulses of despair from without or of frenzy from within. The abbey was amply provisioned. With such precautions, the courtiers might bid defiance to contagion. The external world could take care of itself. In the meantime, it was folly to grieve or to think. The prince had provided all the appliances of pleasure. There were buffoons, there were improvisatori, there were ballet dancers, there were musicians, there was beauty, there was wine. All these and security were within. Without was the Red Death. It was toward the close of the fifth or sixth month of his seclusion, and while the pestilence raged most furiously abroad, that the Prince Prospero entertained his thousand friends at a masked ball of the most unusual magnificence. It was a voluptuous scene, that masquerade. But first, let me tell you of the rooms in which it was held. There were seven, an imperial suite. In many palaces, however, such suites form a long and straight vista, while the folding doors slide back nearly to the walls on either hand, so that the view of the whole extent is scarcely impeded. Here the case was very different, as might have been expected from the Duke's love of the bizarre. The apartments were so irregularly disposed that the vision embraced but little more than one at a time. There was a small turn at every 20 or 30 yards, and at each turn a novel effect. To the right and left, in the middle of each wall, a tall and narrow Gothic window looked out upon a closed corridor which pursued the windings of the suite. These windows were of stained glass, whose color varied in accordance with the prevailing hue of the decorations of the chamber into which it opened. That at the eastern extremity was hung, for example, in blue, and vividly blue were its windows. The second chamber was purple in its ornaments and tapestries, and here the panes were purple. The third was green throughout, and so were the casements. The fourth was furnished and lighted with orange, the fifth with white, the sixth with violet. The seventh apartment was closely shrouded in black velvet tapestries that hung all over the ceiling and down the walls, falling in heavy folds upon a carpet of the same material and hue. But in this chamber only the color of the windows failed to correspond with the decorations. The panes here were scarlet, a deep blood color. Now in no one of the seven apartments was there any lamp or candelabrum amid the profusion of golden ornaments that lay scattered to and fro or depended from the roof. There was no light of any kind emanating from lamp or candle within the suite of chambers, but in the corridors that followed the suite there stood opposite to each window a heavy tripod bearing a brazier of fire that projected its rays through the tinted glass and so glaringly illumined the room. And thus were produced a multitude of gaudy and fantastic appearances. But in the western, or black chamber, the effect of the firelight that streamed upon the dark hangings through the blood-tinted panes was ghastly in the extreme, and produced so wild a look upon the countenances of those who entered that there were few of the company bold enough to set foot within its precincts at all. It was in this apartment also that there stood against the western wall a gigantic clock of ebony. Its pendulum swung to and fro with a dull, heavy, monotonous clang, and when the minute hand made the circuit of the face and the hour was to be stricken, there came from the brazen lungs of the clock a sound which was clear and loud and deep, and exceedingly musical, but of so peculiar a note and emphasis that, at each lapse of an hour, The musicians of the orchestra were constrained to pause momentarily in their performance to hearken to the sound. And thus the waltzers perforce ceased their evolutions, and there was a brief disconcert of the whole gay company. And while the chimes of the clock yet rang, it was observed that the giddiest grew pale, and the more aged and sedate passed their hands over their brows, as if in confused reverie or meditation. But when the echoes had fully ceased, a light laughter at once pervaded the assembly. The musicians looked at each other and smiled, as if at their own nervousness and folly, and made whispering vows to each other that the next chiming of the clock would produce in them no similar emotion. And then, after a lapse of 60 minutes, which embraced 3,600 seconds of the time that flies, there came another chiming of the clock. Then were the same disconcert and tremulousness and meditation as before. But in spite of these things, it was a gay and magnificent revel. The tastes of the Duke were peculiar. He had a fine eye for colors and effects. He disregarded the decora of mere fashion. His plans were bold and fiery, and his conceptions glowed with barbaric luster. There are some who would have thought him mad. His followers felt that he was not. It was necessary to hear and see and touch him to be sure that he was not. He had directed in great part the movable embellishments of the seven chambers upon occasion of this great fête, and it was his own guiding taste which had given character to the masqueraders. Be sure they were grotesque. There were much glare and glitter and piquancy and phantasm, much of what has been since seen in Hernani. There were arabesque figures with unsuited limbs and appointments. There were delirious fancies such as the madman fashions, and there were much of the beautiful, much of the wanton, much of the bizarre, something of the terrible, and not a little of that which might have excited disgust. To and fro in the seven chambers there stalked, in fact, a multitude of dreams, and these, the dreams, writhed in and about, taking hue from the rooms, and causing the wild music of the orchestra to seem but an echo of their steps. And anon there strikes the ebony clock which stands in the hall of the velvet. And then, for a moment, all is still, and all is silent save for the voice of the clock. The dreams are stiff frozen as they stand, but the echo of the chime dies away. They have endured but an instant, and a light, half-subdued laughter floats after them as they depart. And now again the music swells, and the dreams live and writhe to and fro more merrily than ever, taking hue from the many-tinted windows through which stream the rays from the tripods. But to the chamber which lies most eastwardly of the seven, there are now none of the maskers who venture, for the night is waning away, and there flows a ruddier light through the blood-colored panes, and the blackness of the sable drapery appalls. And to him whose foot falls upon the sable carpet, there comes from the near clock of ebony a muffled peal more solemnly emphatic than any which reaches their ears who indulge in the more remote gaieties of the other apartments. But these other apartments were densely crowded, and in them beat feverishly the heart of life, and the revel went whirlingly on, till at length there commenced the sounding of midnight upon the clock. And then the music ceased, as I have told, and the evolutions of the waltzers were quieted, and there was an uneasy cessation of all things as before. But now there were 12 strokes, to be sounded by the bell of the clock. And thus it happened, perhaps, that more of thought crept with more time into the meditations of the thoughtful, of those who reveled. And thus, too, it happened, perhaps, that before the last echo of the last chime had utterly sunk into silence, there were many individuals in the crowd who had found leisure to become aware of the presence of a masked figure which had arrested the attention of no single individual before. And the rumor of this new presence, having spread itself whisperingly around, there arose at length from the whole company a buzz or murmur, expressive of disapprobation and surprise, and then finally of terror and of horror and of disgust. In an assembly of phantasms such as I have painted, it may well be supposed that no ordinary appearance could have excited such sensation. In truth, the masquerade license of the night was nearly unlimited. But the figure in question had out-Heroded Herod, and gone beyond the bounds even of the prince's indefinite decorum. There are chords in the hearts of the most reckless which cannot be touched without emotion, even with the utterly lost, to whom life and death are equally jests. There are matters of which no jest can be made. The whole company, indeed, seemed now deeply to feel that in the costume and bearing of the stranger neither wit nor propriety existed. The figure was tall and gaunt. The mask which concealed the visage was made so nearly to resemble the countenance of a stiffened corpse that the closest scrutiny must have had difficulty in detecting the cheat. And yet all this might have been endured, if not approved, by the mad revelers around. But the mummer had gone so far as to assume the type of the Red Death. His vesture was dabbled in blood, and his broad brow, with all the features of the face, was besprinkled with the scarlet horror. When the eyes of Prince Prospero fell upon this spectral image, which, with a slow and solemn movement, as if more fully to sustain its role, stalked to and fro among the waltzers, he was seen to be convulsed in the first moment with a strong shudder, either of terror or distaste. But in the next, his brow reddened with rage. "Who dares?" he demanded hoarsely of the courtiers who stood near him. "Who dares insult us with this blasphemous mockery? Seize him and unmask him, that we may know whom we have to hang at sunrise from the battlements." It was in the eastern or blue chamber in which stood the Prince Prospero as he uttered these words. They rang throughout the seven rooms loudly and clearly, for the prince was a bold and robust man, and the music had become hushed at the waving of his hand. It was in the blue room where stood the prince with a group of pale courtiers by his side. At first, as he spoke, there was a slight rushing movement of the group in the direction of the intruder, who at the moment was also near at hand, and now, with deliberate and stately step, made closer approach to the speaker. But from a certain nameless awe with which the mad assumptions of the mummer had inspired the whole party, there were found none who put forth hand to seize him, so that unimpeded he passed within a yard of the prince's person, and while the vast assembly, as if with one impulse, shrank from the centres of the room to the walls, he made his way uninterruptedly, but with the same solemn and measured step which had distinguished him from the first, through the blue chamber to the purple, through the purple to the green, through the green to the orange, through this again to the white, and even thence to the violet, ere a decided movement had been made to arrest him. It was then, however, that the Prince Prospero, maddening with rage and shame of his own momentary cowardice, rushed hurriedly through the six chambers, while none followed him on account of a deadly terror that had seized upon all. He bore aloft a drawn dagger, and had approached in rapid impetuosity to within 3 or 4 feet of the retreating figure, when the latter, having attained the extremity of the velvet apartment, turned suddenly and confronted his pursuer. There was a sharp cry, and the dagger dropped, gleaming upon the sable carpet, upon which, instantly afterwards, fell prostrate in death Prince Prospero. Then, summoning the wild courage of despair, a throng of the revellers at once threw themselves into the black apartment, and seizing the mummer, whose tall figure stood erect and motionless in the shadow of the ebony clock, gasped in unutterable horror at finding the grave cerements and corpse-like mask which they handled with so violent a rudeness, untenanted by any tangible form. And now was acknowledged the presence of the Red Death. He had come like a thief in the night, and one by one dropped the revelers in the blood-bedewed halls of their revel, and died, each in the despairing posture of his fall. The life of the ebony clock went out with that of the last of the gay, and the flames of the tripods expired, and darkness and decay, and the Red Death held illimitable dominion over all.
Sounds like that's the last man down. And with that, we've come to the end of the last episode of the Monroe County Civic Theater's Oc-Poe-ber Fest. Hope you had as much fun listening as we did bringing it to you. And though Prince Prospero's party pooped and October's all but over, November's yet to come and MCCT plays on with our 3-part production of Shakespeare's Henry V in a seldom-done uncut version with multiple casting for full community participation. In December, you'll want to zoom in on our holiday review show. And a no longer chilly, but still slightly silly, Billy the Shakespeare's will be back with an episode of our regular podcast of poems and readings from our all-volunteer community. In the meantime, remember, links to all the Poe episodes are available on our website at www.mcct.org in case you missed one or would like to share with a friend. Happy trick-or-treat till the next time we meet. For now, farewell, and may all your weens be hallow. Excuse me. Oh, the bells, the bells, the bells?